First of all, thanks to the organizers for giving me this opportunity to speak to you. So since there are mostly PhD students here, I'm going to do some fairly basic stuff on mixing times. And I will, in my first two talks, concentrate on a technique by David Wilson on lower bounding the mixing time of a Markov chain. I will be mostly concerned with card shuffling here, by which I mean Markov chains with the symmetric group as the state space. But the technique I'm going to introduce is general, but it applies usually very well to the situation with where you're shuffling cards, and in situations where motions of different cards are at least fairly independent. So recall what so we have a Markov chain here. And the XTs belongs to some state space S here. And recall that we usually measure mixing times in terms of the total variation norm. So recall that the total variation norm of the distribution at time t and the stationary distribution. So I'm assuming here that we have a stationary distribution, so that the Markov chain is well, it's discrete time, as you can see here, and it's aperiodic and irreducible. So this is defined as the maximum over all sets A, probability xt in A minus pi of A. The mixing time in terms of the parameter A is the first time when this distance here between our distribution and the stationary distribution goes below a certain limit A here. So, can I? I'm afraid I'm hiding this from you here. So, and one standard here. I mean, this thing will always be between 0 and 1, as you can see. One standard here for A is to take it to be a quarter. So, if you just write tau mix, you would mean tau mix 1 quarter. Okay, so when these studies started out considering mixing times of Markov chains, the most common way to lower bound the mixing time was to use sort of ad hoc test functions. I mean, you look at certain events or test functions in terms of your xt and in terms of the stationary distribution, and if you can see that the chain at time t has a very different probability from the stationary chain for this certain event, you will be far from stationarity. Now, when Wilson introduced his technique, and that was in a paper in 2004, or two papers actually, he came up with a sort of systematic way of finding test functions. And they were in terms of eigenfunctions of the transition matrix. But let me just describe with an example of how you could do this.
Maybe change the...
Yeah, it's going to be. So here's an example of how, what you did before Wilson. Those are good, okay, yeah. So let's take a look at a very simple card shuffle, the top to random shuffle. And that's the shuffle where you, at each step, well, you have a deck of n cards, and you take the top card and insert it at a random place. So if I happen to choose the number 4, I take my top card and put it in position 4. And if I happen to choose position 1, I will just take the top card and put it back again, so nothing happens. So it looks something like this. You have a bunch of cards here. And you take this card here and just insert it at some random place. So what you can do here now is to, well, you start shuffling and wait. You wait until the first time that you happen to take this top card and put it at the bottom position. And the time taken for this will be called T1. So that's the number of shuffles before I put it at the bottom position here. Now, after that, you start new clock and record how many shuffles you need to do after that before you get the top card inserted at one of the two bottom positions. And now you can see the pattern, I suppose. So T3 will after that be the time taken until the first time I put my top card into one of the three bottom positions. Up to Tn like that. So if we let Zt now be the position of the card starting at the bottom, so position of card n. Well, what can be said about the card n? Well, at stationarity, where we have the uniform distribution, the position is of course uniform in the deck here. But if we wait just until time t n over 10, say, well, the bottom card here moves one step up for each t here. So if we have just managed to get n over 10 t's to happen before some time, then of course the bottom card will be in one of the n over 10 bottom positions, which is unlikely in the stationary case. So let's observe this. T1 plus T2 up to Tn over 10. If that sum is greater than some time t, that's implying that the position of the bottom card is at least n 9 over 10 n. Okay, but how long will this take? Well, these t's are independent geometric random variables. So this one is geometric with parameter 1 over n, and this with parameter 2 over n, and 3 over n, etc. So the expected times here are n, n over 2, n over 3, etc. So, and one can actually prove that if we look at the sum here, it will be concentrated around its mean. So the variance will be of lower order than the expectation. So this one will actually be approximately n plus n over 2 plus n over 3. Plus up to n over n divided by 10, which is approximately n times log n over 10 here, just breaking out this n. And this divided by 10 doesn't really matter if n is large, so this is just about n log n. So if you plug in something slightly smaller here than n log n, say 1 minus epsilon times n log n, you will have a very high probability of this event happening. So if t is significantly smaller than n log n, you will have, as I said, very high probability of not having succeeded to move this bottom card up to the top n over 10 part of the deck. So this means that at times lower than this, you will have an almost one probability of having your bottom, the card starting at the bottom, in the bottom 1/10 of the deck. But this has the probability just 1 over 10 in the uniform case. So you will see that the total variation distance at such times will be round about at least n over 10. So that proves that the mixing time will be at least this. And that's an example of the sort of ad hoc test functions you used here. So the test function used here was the position of the card starting at the bottom. But as I said, Wilson came up with sort of a more systematic way of doing this. And he did it in a paper where he, among other things, proved that if you look at the card shuffle you have when you do random transpositions, but only of neighboring cards, transposing neighbors, which was previously known to mix in at most n cubed log n steps, but at least n cubed steps. Well, Wilson introduced this technique and managed to prove that the mixing time was actually of order n cubed log n. Let's see here. So I will I will try to introduce this method in a general setting. So we have here that t goes from 0 to infinity is an irreducible and aperiodic Markov chain. Of course, on a finite state space. Let's call that S. What I want here is an eigenvector of the transition matrix here, a right eigenvector. So what does that mean that this is a right eigenvector? Well, if you look at it as a function on the state space, the probabilistic interpretation is that if you look at the expectation of phi of x t plus 1, given xt, this will be lambda xt. Sorry, lambda phi of xt. And what was lambda? Well, that was my eigenvalue corresponding to this eigenvector. Okay, so to state this result, I will need to assume for simplicity here that lambda is real. And I write it as 1 minus gamma, and I'm assuming that gamma will be at most 1/2. It's just a technical assumption here, but and also, I mean, it's easier and neater to do this when lambda is real. You can actually do it when lambda is complex also. And I'll see if I will have time to get back to that. That situation. But if this, suppose that the Markov chain is reversible, then you will always have real eigenvalues. So this is fairly useful anyway. Okay, so so what can we say here? Well, I'm going to let a number r be the maximum expected square change in of this phi function in one step. So it's max over s of the expectation of phi of x t plus 1 minus phi of x t squared given x t is equal to s. I will also want to assume, just for simplicity and without any loss of generality, that phi of x0 is bigger than 0. OK, so where is the no. The eraser? Yeah, there. Oh, yeah, yeah. There's. Of course. Okay. So, well, the lower bound we get here is the following. I'm going to let t, which is a fixed time now, be the logarithm of phi of x zero minus 1/2. Logarithm of 4r divided by gamma a divided by minus log 1 minus gamma. Then for t less than or equal to this bound here, we have at least a certain distance from stationarity. So namely, we are at least 1 minus a away in total variation norm from stationarity. Now, this expression here is maybe not so nice, but in most situations here, our eigenvalue will be very close to 1. So the gamma will be very close to 0. And we will use a particular a, which might be 3/4, for instance, or well, maybe 1/2, say. So for gamma close to 0, and for instance, just taking a to be 1/2, we get that t is 1 plus some small order term times 1 over gamma log phi x0 minus 1/2 times log 8r over gamma.
Yeah. X0 isn't really so well defined, right? You could multiply your eigenfunction by anything. So are you normalizing in some way?
Well, there will be sort of a normalization in this expression here. So, I mean, if I just scale this one so it becomes larger, then this R will be larger in the same. Yeah. All right. I was considering this is a result which I have had very much use for, so that's why I want to introduce it to you. Maybe I will have time to prove it, because it would be nice to see the proof, because the proof is very elementary. For such a useful method, I think that's nice in itself. But let's see here how this could be used to get the lower bound of order n cubed log n for the neighbor transposition shuffle. So I already defined it orally, but let's do it again. So what I do here is that I pick a position at random, closing my eyes, and then I swap this card with the next card. And for convenience, to make things I'm going to say exactly correct and not just approximately correct, we will use a circular deck convention, which also assigns a probability of 1 over n to transpose the top card with the bottom card here. So the measure of 1, let's call the measure of on Sn for 1 transposition, let's call that nu. We have nu of id being equal to nu of 1, 2, nu of 2, 3. Nu n minus 1 n. Those are all 1 over n. So what can you do here? Well, I'm going almost like here, like before, I'm going to let, like there, I'm going to let ZTI be the position of card I at time t. And card I always means the card starting in position I. Well, then if you look at, you need some sort of divine inspiration to see that this is a good idea. But let's look at the expectation of the cosine of 2 pi zt divided by n. Zti, this could be any I, but let's just drop the I for a bit. Given xt, given the state of the deck at time t. Well, what's this? Well, what will happen with the card in position I? Well, it will move one step down with probability 1 over n, one step up with probability 1 over n, and it will remain in its current position with probability
one minus 2 over m.
I'm just getting confused here why I had n. I'm having n plus 1 moves here, so why did I have that? Thank you. So I forgot that. Yeah.
How does identity, is identity just forced?
Good question here. So the identity is forced in order to avoid periodicity problems. So say if you had just two cards, you would just swap them back and forth either. Okay, so yeah, so with probability 1 minus 2 over n plus 1, nothing happens to this card. T plus
inside the cosine.
Inside the cosine there.
Yeah.
Left on the expected value of z at the next time.
Let's see. There. Thank you. All right. Everything okay now? Good. Then we had the 1 over n plus 1 chance of moving one step up or down the deck. And then also the 1 over n plus 1 chance of moving the other way. But now, of course, everybody knows the formula for the cosine of a sum. So you get here cosine 2 pi zt over n times cosine of 2 pi over n. Minus the product of the sines of the same things. But those sinuses, they will be canceled from this term here, which is the neat thing about this. So this will be actually just 1 minus 2 over n plus 1. So this is the first term, which I'm not changing at all, plus. So we get from each of these terms, we get the product here of cos 2 pi zt divided by n times cos of 2 pi over n. All right. But here, of course, we can take out this factor here. And if we do that, we get that this is 1 minus gamma times cos 2 pi zt divided by n. If we just put gamma to be, well, what does it become? I have to check my notes here. All the time, it becomes it becomes 2 times 1 minus cosine 2 pi over n divided by n plus 1. Now, if n is large, this is a cosine of a very small thing, so we can use a Taylor formula approximation without being too wrong. So this is 1 plus some small order term, and it turns out that it's 4 pi squared. Well, we get n squared here and another n here, so it's 4 pi squared over n cubed. So we actually see here, well, what do we see? We see that we have this setting over here. So phi is now cosine of 2 pi zt over n. And lambda is 1 minus that gamma over there. So we can take phi to be cosine of 2 pi zt over n, and gamma equal to what I just wrote there. Okay, so, but that was an eigenvector corresponding to one card. But of course, I mean, this works for any card. So let's take, let's sum these over I, but let's use half of the cards in order to keep some randomness here. So maybe I should just wrote phi I of that one in order to denote the difference between that and what I'm writing now here. So we let this be sum I goes from 1 through m of cos 2 pi zt I divided by n. So each of these guys is an eigenvector, so the sum is an eigenvector too. And here, what's m here? Well, m is n over 2. So half of the cards. Okay, so things are almost set up to use this this result here, but of course we need this expected square change as well. But look at what happens in one step. In one step, at most, well, only two cards will move, and they will move by only one step. So, so this guy here will change. Well, suppose that we pick two cards which we count here, then of course nothing will change, right? And also, if we pick two cards which are not among the m first, nothing will change. So we only have a change if we transpose one card among these m first by another card. And well, taking that into account, we can say that r is at most. Well, what happens if we transpose a card in this deck, or in among these first ones, one step? Well, you will go from cos 2 pi zti over n to cos 2 pi zti minus 1 or plus 1. Oh. So cos of some position, 2 pi I, say, divided by n, minus 2 pi over n, or plus, it doesn't really matter here, because we want to make this as large as possible then, afterwards. So it gets this value, which was changed from cos 2 pi I divided by n. Now, of course, how big this difference is depends on I. So the worst possible change we could have is what we get by taking maximum over positions I there. Uh, And if we look at the cosine function, well, the worst possible case is if we on in the unit circle are up here somewhere and moving one step. So the worst possible thing we can take is to take I right up there so that the cosine is zero. And this thing here then will be cosine of pi over 2 minus 2 pi over n. But this is the same as, well, a square 2. But this is the same as sinus of 2 pi over n, which is about 2 pi over n. So this is about or less than or equal to 4 pi squared over n squared. And now we're set. So we can take r. So we have r less than 4 pi squared over n squared. And we had our gamma here, 4 pi squared over n cubed. So everything is, well, not everything is set, because we can, we also need to know the value of this phi when we start. And of course, I mean, since we are doing a random walk on a group here, the starting position doesn't really matter for the mixing time. So I can start with my cards in a position which makes phi of x0 as large as possible, which it will be if I put all my cards, which I count in the sum on the right-hand side. And if I do that, I will have that phi of x0 is, well, the contribution of every card is of order 1 here, so this is of order n. OK, so now let's just plug it in. So what do we get here? We get this t. Well, the t there, well, we can use this formula because gamma and is very small. So we get 1 plus order 1 times 1 over gamma, which is n cubed over 4 pi squared. Times log of Cn minus a half log of R, which is four times, oh, sorry, so it's 8 times 4 times pi squared over n squared. So it's 32 pi squared over n squared. Of course, this constant 32 is not so important here. And we divide this by gamma, which was 4 pi squared over n cubed. But as I said, since we're taking logarithm here, these constants are immaterial. And this constant is also not important in the long run. So what we have here is log n, essentially log n minus half log n. So we get to half log n here. So in the end, we get n cubed over 8 pi squared log n. So here we have a lower bound. The mixing time is at least this much. And I think it's nice that I mean that it's elementary enough that I can tell you in 3/4 of an hour. But it was, I mean, it was unknown until 2004. So
it might be worth saying that it matches the upper bound the
yeah.
approximation?
Yeah, it does match the upper bound with a good approximation. And what I also should say that it's actually known now in a recent paper by Hubert Lacoin, the exact value of this constant here. But I don't really remember if it's a 4 here, if it's a 2. Does anybody remember? No. But there is a paper by Hubert Lacoin which will appear in Annals of Probability, and it gives actually the exact right order. And Wilson's technique here actually gives the right order. So when Wilson proved his theorem, the upper and lower bounds were off by a factor 1, by a factor 2. And the upper bound was from the 80s, I think it was David Aldous who did that, by a coupling argument and approximating the motion of a card with Brownian motion. But what Lacoin did then was to improve the upper bound for the mixing time, essentially. With a completely different method. So he uses some kind of monotonicity he imposes a partial order on the set of permutations, which is always kept by one move in according to this Markov chain. I've not really managed to penetrate his paper fully, I have to admit.
Is it conceivable that this method, with an appropriate choice of a function, could give the right function?
Well, it seems that it's often off by a factor 2. So if you do this for ordinary random transpositions, you will typically get 1/4 n log n. A half n log n is the right constant there. Okay. In this case, it gives the sharp.
In this case, also.
In
many cases, it gives the sharp.
Okay, it does. But not, yeah.
I should say that David Wilson, in his original paper, proved an improved upper bound analysis using the monotonicity. So the monotonicity was not the new idea of the quantum.
Okay. Thanks. Okay, so so this I had planned to give a proof here, and I see that I have some time left over. So I mean, since this is a very useful technique, it would be nice to see a proof. So I will give it to you. And it's completely elementary. So what you do here is that let's start to take x according to the stationary distribution. And we have that. By assumption here, the expectation of phi of xt plus 1 is the, well, we can condition on xt. And we see that this is 1 minus gamma times phi of xt. But then taking 1 minus gamma outside the expectation gives 1 minus gamma times the expectation of phi of xt. So that's just by definition. So this is a simple thing. And if we iterate this, we get that the expectation of phi of xt is equal to 1 minus gamma to the t of phi of x0. And I assume here that x0 is fixed so that the expectation vanishes. Now, of course, if you iterate this up till time infinity, you will get the expectation of phi of x, which will, since gamma is positive, which will become zero. Okay. Now let's write delta phi as the change from time t to time t plus one. Now, of course, if we look at phi of x t plus 1 and take the square of this, well, we can, of course, write this thing phi of x as phi of x t plus delta phi and square that thing. So we get phi of x t squared plus 2 phi x t delta phi plus delta phi squared. Just expanding the square. And if we take the expectation of this, well, we get this one is 1 minus gamma times that one. So we have that E of delta phi given xt is minus gamma phi of xt. So if we take the expectation of this squared here, we have that we get that, well, let's write this first. Oh, sorry, I want a condition on xt there as well. So let's look at the expectation of phi of xt plus 1 squared given xt. Well, this is just a constant then. This one is minus, has expectation minus gamma. This is a constant. And this is bounded by R by assumption. So what we get here is that we get 1 from here minus 2 gamma from here. Phi of xt plus r. Now we can use induction on this, almost as we did there, but a little more complicated. And now this technical assumption that gamma is less than a half comes in order to make to be able to do this induction. And it's nothing really complicated happens there. So we get by induction, well, it's not obvious what we get, but we get that E of phi of xt squared is less than or equal to 1 minus 2 gamma to the t by x0 squared plus r divided by 2 gamma. Sorry? Oh, yeah, thanks. But now we can compute the variance here. So the idea now is to compute the variance, or upper bound the variance, of phi of xt, and just use Chebyshev's inequality. So let's see here. What do we get? Well, if we want the variance, we want this one minus the expectation squared. So we have something which is less than or equal to this thing minus the expectation squared. So then we get 1 minus gamma to the 2t there, which is slightly bigger than 1 minus 2t to the t, 2 gamma to the t, sorry. So what we end up with is that the variance of phi of xt is actually less than or equal to 2r over gamma. Again, because this thing is actually smaller than the square of this thing here. Okay, but now it's let's just plug this into Chebyshev's inequality. So the probability that phi of xt minus its expectation is greater than or equal to, well, you have to choose something which fits with the bounds you have. So let's take square root of 2r over gamma. Well, it's less than the square of this divided by the variance divided by the square. So r over 2 gamma divided by r over 2 r over gamma. So did I get that one? I think I was wrong here. It should be 2r over gamma. So here it. No, sorry. That was right. And I also want an A there. So
you want R over 2 gamma there also, right? Now that you've changed
that. There was a lot of things, a lot of small things wrong here. I'm very sorry. I had it right in my notes. Now everything fits. So this is A over 2. Now if we take t to go to infinity, well, we had that the expectation of phi of x was 0, and the variance of phi of x is, of course, less than or equal to r over 2 gamma. Again, using Chebyshev's inequality, we get that the probability that the absolute value of phi of x exceeds r square root of r over gamma a is less than or equal to a over 2 in the same way. What we can observe here is that the total variation distance will between the distribution at time t and the stationary distribution will be at least 1 minus a, provided that the expectation is 2 times this thing here. So this total variation distance is at least 1 minus a if the expectation of phi of xt is greater than or equal to 2 square root of r divided by gamma a. But the expectation, we know the expectation. It's here. It's this thing. So this is saying that is the same thing as saying that 1 minus gamma to the t times phi of x0 is greater than or equal to 2 times square root of r divided by gamma a. But this is not a very difficult algebraic task to solve this inequality. This becomes that t is at most what we claimed here. Did I have the general t somewhere? No. It's gone now. So let's write it again. It's minus log to the base 1 minus gamma of phi of x0 divided by square root of 4 r divided by gamma a, which is the same thing as the t we wrote. So completely elementary proof. But still powerful enough to prove this long-standing open question. So I think it's a nice method, which you now know. I'm finished with what I planned to talk about here. Now, before lunch, I will stand here again this afternoon, and then I will talk about some extensions and variants that I've been working on of this method. And I will mainly focus on the move to front rule, but let's get back to what that is later. So thanks for now.